Okay, could I invite members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and quietly as possible? And the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 1820 in the name of Paul McLennan on 16 days of activism against gender-based violence. The debate will be concluded without any questions being posed. I would invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Paul McLennan to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I recently met with staff and women supported by Women's Aid East and Midlothian. I heard their experiences of women who have fled from domestic abuse and had the opportunity to understand the impact the violence they were subject to has had on them and on their children. These brave women have had their lives turned upside down after finding the courage to escape their abuser. Thankfully, they were able to do so safely. Recent figures show that every 3 days in East Lothian, a woman suffers and reports domestic abuse. That's only cases that are reported. Since leaving, they told me they have faced challenges in finding a home to call their own, as the service has not been designed to support women who flee violence. I remember taking part in an event organised by Women's Aid and the White Ribbon Campaign about 10 years ago when I was council leader. The exercise looked at what happened when a case was reported and how many people and organisations it impacted on. It started with a ball of string, and this was a woman who was reporting domestic abuse, and it was passed round to all organisations and to who had all been affected. By the end, there was about 30 of us standing up, and that stayed with me to this day. Today's debate pays homage to the 16 days of activism against gender-based violence, a time to galvanise action to prevent and end violence against women and girls around the world. I know and I'm aware this is the third debate we've had on this issue in the last 16 days, and thanks to everybody who's contributed so far. This year marks the 30th anniversary of the Global 16 Days campaign. It was inspired by the original vision and history of the campaign, which focused on raising awareness about violence against women. This year, the campaign will focus on the issue of femicide or the gender-related killing of women. A theme that feels especially pertinent this year after the high-profile murder of Sarah Everard by Metropolitan Police Officer Wayne Cousins. Sadly, Sarah's murder is not an isolated incident. Since the beginning of 2021, there have been at least 122 women killed by men or where a man is a principal suspect in the UK. In that period, I've done a lot of reflecting on the role I have as a man in preventing acts of violence against women of any kind. Last month, Police Scotland launched an incredibly important Don't Be That Guy campaign, calling men to consider the potential responsibility for violence against women. The campaign is explicit. Men, we can make a real difference by taking a hard look at our attitudes and behaviour at home, at work and socialising with our mates. As men, we need to stop contributing to a culture that targets, minimises, demeans and brutalises women. We need to talk openly to our male friends and relatives about behaviour that's damaging to women and puts men at risk of offending. We need to take women's safety seriously. We can't say that enough. Not just when a woman is murdered, but all year round. And we must shift the way we understand violence against women. It's not a woman's problem. It's ours, and it always has been. To do this, we need to redefine violence in our own minds. Now, I recently spoke at an SNP conference in a debate led by my colleague Sally Donald, and she talked about street harassment. It's an everyday occurrence for women and girls in Scotland, and I'm going to ask the Minister and his summing up, will he meet Sally and I to discuss this issue in more detail? Graeme Golden, formerly of the Violence Reduction Unit in Glasgow, has called on us men to define violence in a way that would help us individually prevent it. In a blog for the Don't Be That Guy campaign, he says, when I see the term violence, I look at it as more than an attitude, a behaviour rather than a physical act. When we do this, we can start to address behaviours and attitudes that can, if challenged, lead to another act of violence, like murder, sexual assault and rape. When we don't focus on these behaviours, when we remain silent about what we see and what we hear, we give permission for abuse and violence to take place. Graeme couldn't be any more correct. Violence against women is both a cause and consequence of gender inequality in our society. Gender stereotypes are enforced from an early age. Rape culture and harmful behaviours are normalised and survivors are blamed for their abuser's action. We place responsibility on women to be careful, not to walk home alone. I've heard the comment, wear flat shoes. That's incredible. To watch her drink on a night out and cover up instead of teaching men not to rape, spike and harm women. This has never been acceptable. I want to see a Scotland where women and girls thrive as equal citizens, socially, culturally, economically and politically. I want to live in a Scottish society where women and girls are safe, respected and equal in our own communities, where women and men have equal access to power and resources, and positive gender roles are promoted. We need to embed gender competency into our policy making, gender-based budgeting into everything that we do. Scotland's Equally Safe strategy is taking strides towards achieving this goal, but we all have our own role in turning this vision into reality. It is all our, especially men's, responsibility to change the culture we live in that trivialises and condones violence against women and girls. And I'm making a challenge to every single MSP in this Parliament. We need to be standing here this time next year, put our hand on our heart and say we've played our part in speaking out against male violence against women. Not just today, not just in the 16 days, but every single day. Now, I'm in the process of organising a roundtable for all male MSPs with organisations who are involved in the campaign to support women. I'm also arranging a parliamentary reception with the same groups. These dates hopefully will be before Easter. To conclude the opening of this debate on the annual 16 Days of Activism, I want to pay tribute to the strength and resilience of survivors and to the organisations like Rape Crisis Scotland, Zero Tolerance, Scotland's Women's Aid and White Ribbon, who work day and night to support women who have experienced male violence. And I want to remember all the women who have made it this far, those who have lost their lives to male violence. I'd like to end on a quote from the United Nations Secretary-General Ban Ki-moon. There is one universal truth applicable to all countries, cultures and communities. Violence against women is never acceptable, never excusable, never tolerable. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McLennan. Before calling the next speaker, just to advise colleagues, there is a large amount of interest, understandably, in participating in this debate, so I think it's likely we will have to extend the time available, and we will do that at an appropriate stage in the debate. But for now, can I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Russell Findlay for around 4 minutes, Ms. Nicholl.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I wish to thank Paul McLennan for bringing this motion forward today, and again acknowledge the resilience of women and girls who are experiencing or have survived gender-based violence in Scotland and beyond. Last week, during our second debate on this issue, the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans made a very valid point that the experiences of female veterans had not been mentioned. He alluded to the experience of women in the armed forces and made reference to his recent visit to a veterans facility in Fife that was supporting a survivor of gender-based violence. Today I want to pick up on this issue, but firstly pay tribute to all women serving in and veterans of our military for their commitment, bravery and sacrifice in safeguarding our national security. There are over 20,000 servicewomen in our armed forces. Women can now apply for all the same roles as men. There is no doubt the armed forces provide women with fulfilling careers and vast opportunities. However, for many women in the military, their experiences are very different. Earlier this year, the UK Government Defence Committee published its report, Protecting Those Who Protect Us, Women in the Armed Forces, from Recruitment to Civilian Life, following its inquiry into the situation of and challenges facing women in the armed forces today. The report found, and I quote, there is too much bullying, harassment and discrimination and criminal behaviour such as sexual assault and rape affecting service personnel, and there is no doubt that female personnel suffer disproportionately. The stories we heard are truly shocking and gravely concern us. They are disappointing given the MOD's commitment to ending unacceptable behaviours. This behaviour is harming the health, careers and operational effectiveness of service personnel and has no place in the military. The forces and the MOD must root out these behaviours and respond better when they occur. The report also explored the experiences of female veterans and concluded that while many reported positive experiences transitioning to civilian life, many reported challenges relating to physical or mental health issues, relationship problems, debt and unemployment. Dr. Beverly Bergman of the Scottish Veterans Health Research Group highlighted that there are few female-specific veteran services in the UK, noting that many women prefer gender-based services, especially if they have been the victim of sexual or domestic abuse or harassment. And work is now underway to address the many issues raised in the report. While the findings in this report are stark, they must offer an opportunity for change. The Scottish Government strategy, Support for the Veterans and Armed Forces Community, outlines our approach to supporting veterans across issues including mental health, homelessness and substance misuse, and sets out the vital role of the Scottish Veterans Fund, the Unforgotten Forces Consortium, third sector partners and charities, all under the watchful eye of our Veterans Commissioner. However, support for women remains very limited, and while programmes such as the Women's Returner programme that supports women back into work, there is still so much more to do in addressing the specific challenges women face that arise from the impact of gender-based violence. Presiding Officer, while recognising defence as a reserved matter, nonetheless, I urge the Scottish Government to use the powers it does have to ensure women are front and centre of our continuing efforts to tackle this issue, and I look forward to working with the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister to take this very important work forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. I now call on Russell Finlay to be followed by Pauline McNeill. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Finlay.
Sure, thank you. Last week, I spoke in another debate about violence against women and girls, and it's proper and indeed necessary for us to be doing so again today, and I congratulate Mr McLennan for securing this debate. Many of last week's speakers highlighted the reality of women and girls in modern Scotland. This can include everyday experiences of discrimination and misogyny. Then there are the sexual assaults and rapes, the drink-spiking predators, violence and abuse in the home, trafficking for sex, stalking and revenge porn, the pressure on young girls to act in a sexualised way. One revelation was that on average, a woman is killed by a man every 3 days in the United Kingdom. The common denominator in all of this is men. Society is beginning to understand that it is on men to accept wrongdoing, to change and to challenge others. As Mr McLennan said, we all bear responsibility. Last week, I spoke about Esther Brown, who was sexually violated and beaten to death in her own home by a registered sex offender whose 23 previous convictions included the rape of another woman in her home. I asked questions of Police Scotland on behalf of some of Esther's friends, but we were fobbed off. Despite the rhetoric of compassion, the impersonal criminal justice system suffers from, I believe, an entrenched secrecy. That secrecy and an accountability vacuum means that victims will continue to be failed. Today, I would like to speak about another disturbing case in which I've had a direct involvement. It is a partially told account of a paedophile ring operating in the heart of Edinburgh. In 1997, a girl aged 10 accused a man called David Scott of sexually abusing her. She says she was not believed. She believes she was punished for speaking out. She tried to take her own life. She lives with the trauma of her abuse every single day. In 2018, more than 20 years later, Scott was finally jailed for sexually abusing her and five other girls over a 45-year period. Why, his victims ask, was this prolific paedophile free to target other children for 2 decades? After reporting on this horrific case for the BBC, I spoke with the family of one of Scott's later victims. She was aged 8 when the abuse began, but Scott did not act alone. This girl gave police a detailed account of being targeted by 5 other men at a flat in Blackfriars Street, only half a mile from this spot. She saw Scott taking cash from these men. Her family urged the police to investigate. Just last week, one of those men was jailed for 11 years for abusing this same girl and a boy. Gary Thompson was that man. He was the tenant of the Blackfriars Street flat. Only now is the link between Thompson and Scott being made public. Evidence of paedophiles colluding in organised abuse is shocking and obscene. But what of the other men in this flat? Police Scotland tell me that inquiries are continuing. It is also worth saying that for anyone with any concerns or seeking information on abuse, please see the website of the National Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Children. And the next time a child speaks out, they must be listened to. I would just quickly like to conclude by echoing Mr. McLennan's comments that activism and awareness isn't just for 16 days, but should be for every single day.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. I now call on Polly McNeill to be followed by Jim Fairley. Again, 4 minutes, Ms. McNeill.
I first of all want to thank Paul McLennan for bringing this to members' debate this evening, and apologies to presiding officer and members that will have to leave a wee bit early to attend the session with the presiding officer this evening. But I hope members know that I'm absolutely committed to this important issue, and it's the third time I've spoke, like others, in the last couple of weeks. We've witnessed in recent times an increase in domestic violence, the murder of women and so on. And it's a reminder, if it was ever needed, the violence against women is sadly endemic in our society, and it's global. It's not just in Scotland and the UK. We face endemic problems of violence against women by men, but it's across the world. We must do our bit. Violence against women in the overwhelming majority of cases is men's violence against women. And when some men say it isn't all men, they are perhaps missing the point. Of course, not all men are violent. But I think the point I hope that Paul McLennan is trying to make, and I do agree, that men must be part of the solution. We cannot do it without men. Men must address this problem amongst their own sex. The issue that violence against women has probably not had the highest priority that it should have. This Parliament must make a difference. We must believe that by the end of this 4 and a bit years that we have still to go, that we are going to begin to change this picture and reverse these statistics. For decades, there has indeed been a lack of male voices speaking about violence against women. And I hope that's changing. It may be changing. But I think it's important to say that there must be a serious analysis of why women are subjected to everyday sexism, workplace sexism, and some of the speeches that have been made already address different parts of our society. It's everywhere you want to look. And I did read the story recently about women in the military who said that it became this commonplace for them to be expected to be groped in training sessions. This is in our military, and we know we've got endemic problems in our police service too. But I believe there's a big connection with what happens in our schools and the way that women and girls are treated. I was shocked to watch the Zara McDermott recent BBC documentary uncovering rape culture, which looks at the burgeoning rape culture in British schools. And I did call in last week for there to be an assessment as to whether or not we have this problem in Scotland. I'd be surprised if we didn't. It was shocking to learn that boys as young as 9 and 10 were viewing online pornography. And of course, I do believe this affects the way they view girls and understand sex. A recent report by academics from University College London and Kent University, amongst other institutions, highlight that the sending and receiving of unsolicited sexual images is now becoming dangerously normalised. It's a normalisation of that that gives me real cause for concern, especially for girls. A study involving young people aged 12 to 18 found that most girls had received an image of male genitalia, often from adult men who were strangers. And the report said, unfortunately, this form of image-based sexual harassment was often experienced on a regular basis. And over half of the boys and girls who had received unwanted sexual content online or had their image shared without their consent did nothing about it. Girls also felt pressurised to trade intimate images with boys who sent pictures unsolicited. They were mocked or bullied in their photos, and they were shared amongst their classmates. We must know if this is something that's happening in Scottish schools, and we must understand the connection that there is with the way that girls and women are treated. Social media like TikTok and Snapchat must be tackled because they are enabling some of this grooming to take place. I close, presiding officer, by saying I wholeheartedly agree with this motion. And I do believe that the collective efforts of the parties and the individuals here who spoke eloquently and believe with all their heart that this has to change for women and girls in our country, we must make sure we use this Parliament to make an absolute fundamental change to those figures to stop women being violated and girls being abused. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. I now call on Jim Fairley, who will be followed by Stephen Kerr. Again, 4 minutes, please, Mr Fairley.
Officer, I'd like to congratulate my colleague Paul McLennan on securing today's debate, and I happily support his continued efforts in raising the awareness of the issue, despite it continuing to blight our society. Too little focus or attention is given to the changing the culture which allows it to continue unabated. 2 weeks ago, I spoke in the Government's debate on International Day for Elimination of Violence Against Women and Girls, and I emphasised the role we men must play in changing the culture, and as I usually do, I shared that speech as widely as I could on social media. We all use these platforms to convey all sorts of messages, and this chamber is exactly the place to raise those messages. And for example, I have posted in the past my dismay at photographs of boxes or eggs that have displayed a Union Jack in them rather than a Saltire in defence of a Scottish brand. My social media account explodes. I switch off the sound notifications because it literally doesn't stop for days on end. The outrage and sheer fury from the grossly offended are palpable and can set off a chain sideshow of explosions that continue in my notifications for sometimes for weeks. And yet, I post a speech about the savagery of male violence against women and girls, about sexual assault, rape and murder, and how we males must take a stand on behalf of women and girls and ask how we help to change things. And what is the response? Muted at best. Where was the anger? Where was the outrage? Where was the explosion of fury of support for women and girls and condemnation of male violence perpetrated against them? Sadly, and even more predictably, the outrage and fury didn't materialise. Social media can be a powerful tool to raise awareness, to start debate and to engage with people whose opinions often differ with our own. And as long as we're able to hold that space for those debates to happen with fairness and without vitriol, as I often see, we should continue to engage in all political matters online, but especially this one. Now, I know that this discussion is painful and uncomfortable for men. There's a fear that by sticking your head above the parapet, you might draw attention to yourself and someone somewhere reminds you about a time when you may have been that guy. So better not to be reminded or risk the embarrassment. But if we all admit that at one point or another, most males will have done something that would now give us pause and forced us to accept that difficult and uncomfortable memory and a version of ourselves that when we know that we most definitely were that guy. And if we all admit it together and to ourselves, it will become easier to identify it in the next generation of boys and men and stop it at its root. Part of this is the growing up process in a patriarchal system which not only doesn't condemn this behaviour, it actively encourages it in all the ways that I spoke about to you 2 weeks ago. Most of us growing up with these behaviours, and we can chalk it up to experience, to growing up or whatever we want to call it, but some men never grow up. Let's not forget that even if we do grow or learn, at whose expense does it come? Because when men are doing all that growing up and learning, it's women they are trying those behaviours out on, and it's women who are learning that they need to protect themselves and cannot know which of these boys will grow out of it, and for them, who's it going to escalate it from? There's a real issue that needs to be addressed about ignoring male violence against women and girls, and it's something that others do and therefore isn't our problem. Unless, of course, it happens to be one of our own, or it happens to be someone that the media deem worthy of wall-to-wall coverage. And as I said, this conversation should make us all feel at least a little bit uncomfortable. If we're going to be honest and be honest with ourselves, we all know exactly what I'm talking about. We learn the boundaries. We know what flirting is. We know what a compliment is. We know when the interaction is accepted and reciprocated. It is actually really obvious to all of us. But we also know what no means. We know when our embarrassment leads to aggression or inappropriate continuation of advances. And we also all know someone in our group as we grew up who might just have been capable of going that bit further than they should have. And we say nothing about it because that's not what guys do. This is a difficult debate for us to have as men, and I know that. And there's no doubt about it. But by avoiding it, we enable society to continue to be muted at the misogyny, sexism, objectification, violence and sexual assault, rape and murder of far too many young women and girls every year. I believe that we can and we must do more to change it. We can change the culture, by example, by crossing the road and give women space. We remain respectful in every setting. We use appropriate language. We take that 8 seconds of discomfort and calling it out, which is made all the easier by the phrase, don't be that guy. We teach our sons what is acceptable, what is unacceptable, and how not to cross the line. And as importantly, we teach our daughters not to accept that line being crossed. I firmly believe that huge impacts can be made when small changes are made by the many, and I call on everyone to be that bit more mindful, to recognise these behaviours. We know how to when we cross the line and create a different culture to bring up the next generation of boys to men. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. I now call on Stephen Kerr to be followed by Carol Mochan. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr. Kerr.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I congratulate Paul McLennan for bringing forward this important motion. I thank all those who supported him to enable it. And I also thank him on his excellent speech that he gave in opening debate. Gender-based violence is a stain on our society. Our streets should be safe, places for everyone. But for far too many women and girls, we know that they are not safe. And we only have to look back on the horrific crime that took place in London on the 4th of March this year, when, while walking home, Sarah Everard was kidnapped in the street, was driven away to be raped, strangled and murdered. That this murder was perpetrated by a police officer is truly shocking. It was his duty to protect people and make the streets safe. He abused his position to murder an innocent woman. We have a long way to go. Women should feel safe in their homes. They should feel safe in the streets. And they should feel safe when they're going about their daily business. I remember just a few years ago talking to a group of young women who came to see me to tell me about their experience of this issue. They told me, frankly, a terrible story of the lack of respect and the casual harassment that they and their peers had to put up with on a daily basis. They were subject to leering, groping, intimidation, and sleazy behaviour by some of the young men around them. When one person can treat another person in a derogatory way, when they show so little respect to make another person feel objectified or intimidated, we are all made smaller. This casual objectification leads to escalating levels of disrespect. One small aggressive statement, one casual unwanted touch, is the first step in a path that can lead to something far worse and far more serious. We cannot disregard such issues. We have a long way to go. Earlier this year, the UK Parliament passed the Domestic Abuse Act into law. This Act will transform the support available to women right across our society. It will also ensure that perpetrators feel the full force of the law. This is a step in the right direction. Inadvertently, but entirely predictably, the steps taken to avoid COVID have exacerbated the issue that we're addressing. Across the world, governments responded to the COVID-19 pandemic by initiating lockdowns to slow down the spread of the virus. And one side effect of this policy was it made it even more difficult for vulnerable women to get away from an abusive partner. So that between April and June 2020, there was a 65% increase in calls to the National Domestic Abuse Helpline when compared to the first 3 months of that year. And Karen Ingala-Smith, who runs the Counting Dead Women Project, estimated that during the first 3 weeks of the first lockdown, there had been 16 domestic abuse killings of men and women in the UK, the highest for at least 11 years. We have a long way to go. The escalation of violence towards women during COVID-19 can also be seen overseas. Dame Vera Baird, the Victims Commissioner for England and Wales, said that China saw a doubling of domestic abuse during the height of the pandemic. With cases rising all over the world, the UN Secretary General has described a horrifying global surge in domestic violence. As legislators, we must be constantly vigilant as to how the law can be used and kept up to date to reduce violence against women. As leaders, we must set an example. And I am glad to see so many men, over the course of the 3 debates we've had, stand up in this place and commit to work to eliminate violence against women and girls. And I thank Paul McLennan for the initiative he announced in his speech at the start of the debate. It is true, Deputy Presiding Officer, that we have a long way to go, but I see hope, and I can see that much more needs to be done. As a nation, as a country, as a human race, We must look into our hearts and establish the true cause of violence. The legal abolition of violence must be accompanied by the abolition of toxic and hateful environments and the acceptance of compassion and respect. Yes, we have a long way to go, but I have faith in the goodness of humanity to get to the place where everyone, all women and girls, feel safe, respected and valued in our society.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I now call on Carol Mochan to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms. Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Paul McLellan for securing this additional debate, allowing us once again to raise this important issue on the week of International Human Rights Day and to mark the 30th anniversary of the 16 days of activism. I share the sentiment expressed here today and want to add to other members' voices. Violence against women is not only sadly still a major concern in 2021, but it appears to be getting worse in Scotland and around the world. If anyone imagines that it's become a thing of the past, then they are sorely mistaken. As a new member offered the opportunity to contribute to this debate, I see that Paul McLennan has become a champion on this issue, calling men to take the responsibility in society seriously. I thank him, and in the last debate I was in, thank Jim Fairley for raising the number of men in attendance in the chamber. And again, I thank them for that and for the call to action in reminding all male MSPs to join the debate tonight and in other debates. In making this statement, I really reflected on the fact that this motion marks 30 years of the 16 days of activism against gender-based violence. Whilst this work is to be commended as absolutely essential, it should spur us on in this chamber to realise that we have a responsibility to work hard, to make decisions, to focus on action, not rhetoric, and to ensure that we do not have to make the same remarks in years to come. The motion quite rightly seeks to acknowledge and praise services devoted to supporting and eliminating violence against women. It is genuinely sad, however, that the campaign for 16 days of action is in its 30th year, and yet we know the violence continues and accountability is severely lacking. When I made my first speech at the start of the 16 days of violence against women, we knew that at least 126 women had been killed by men, or a man is the principal suspect in their death in the UK. And since this time, we know of other women subjected to violence and those who have sadly lost their lives. How can we look at those numbers and think there is not a serious problem in our society with the way men view and treat women? Whether it's domestic violence, sexual harassment, or indeed rampant misogyny, women continue to be the target of far too many men's terrible behaviours and aggression. And if we cannot understand how serious that is today and address it at the root cause, then we don't deserve to be standing here in this chamber. Across the many debates in this Parliament, members across the chamber have raised many important issues. So many vital changes we need in our society, from calling out language and misogyny or changes to the justice system. Yet I have often wondered if this many men were saying they had fallen victim, would the statistics be the same? My previous contribution focused on the establishment of institutions that at times feel they are above the issue, and I want to just mention this again. Each woman who is the victim of violence must be treated equally and fairly by an establishment that understands, or at least seeks to begin to understand, what they have gone through. That begins with accepting this is a serious problem we do not have under control, and it means more direct engagement with grassroots organisations, health and recovery charities, and for institutions to actually open their eyes and ears to what is going on. Finally, Presiding Officer, we need to think about the sort of attitudes we are exposing young men to, which encourage a culture of entitlement instead of one of respect. If we can approach this problem as both a societal issue, which is absolutely mixed in with the way men think it is acceptable to behave, we can begin to tackle it. Until then, it will just be more about talk and not taken seriously enough. If we want to make a change, then we have to actually do something about it. And I thank all the members for coming to this important debate. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mochan. And I call on Maggie Chapman to be followed by Emma Harper again, around 4 minutes, Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank Paul McLennan for securing this debate this evening. I've been swithering over whether to speak in this debate or not, but here I am. And I am here because I can be. I have a voice, and I can use it. Not all women have that privilege. So I have a responsibility to use my voice in the ongoing fight for gender equality, even though it is often an exhausting, frustrating, demoralising fight. We know that gender-based violence is a cause and a consequence of gender inequality. We also know that there is nothing inevitable about this. We still live in a deeply patriarchal world. But I am not going to rehearse the arguments for equality here or talk about the policies we need to achieve it. I am not going to repeat the statistics of either inequality or its impact on society, though they are harrowing, life-changing, life-ending. I am not even going to relay examples of the trauma experienced by women. What I do want to use my voice for this evening is to challenge each and every man in this chamber to up his game. In Paul McLennan's email about this evening, he specifically asked men MSPs to be here. On the 25th of November, we had a debate on violence against women and girls. On the 30th of November, we had a debate about justice and the 16 days of activism. Over the course of these two debates, 8 men spoke, 4 in each one. 23 women spoke. In the justice debate, there were 3 interventions, all by men, 2 intervening on women. Why do these numbers matter? Well, I think they are telling that in a parliament that is just under 35% women, 75% of speakers in those debates were women. On the face of it, that isn't surprising. Women face the consequences of gender inequality every day. Women have lived experience of it. Of course, we can expect women to have lots to say about it, and it is right that we listen to women. But that only 8 of 84 men thought they should contribute to these important debates speaks volumes too, because it is you, men, who are the perpetrators of the vast, vast majority of violence against women. So I challenge all the men in this parliament to look critically at your behaviour. You have a responsibility in this, a responsibility to call out sexist behaviour and language whenever you encounter it, including in your own heads, 365 days a year. A responsibility to consider your behaviour in this place of work, in your social, private and intimate settings. But importantly, in this chamber too, because even in this chamber, gender inequality is obvious and it is damaging. Presiding Officer, I have, in those recent debates, paid tribute to the organisations and individuals who work to support survivors, who raise awareness about gender inequality, who put their bodies on the line every day to do this work. This evening, I want to close by paying tribute to one of those organisations and all those who turned out to support them last night. RASAC Dundee and Angus, the Women's Rape and Sexual Abuse Centre, held an event in the cold and dark on Dundee's waterfront. Their Keys to a Safer Future event saw people gather together to write messages, mostly of hope, on a tag and tie it with a key to the waterfront fencing. Many women, probably many of us in this building, have carried keys or similar in our fists as defence against the fear and intimidation we face on a daily and nightly basis. The event in Dundee was a bold statement of intent to reject the fear, the intimidation that for so long has kept women afraid, has prevented them from walking alone. I wasn't able to be there, but I want to close with the words written on one of those tags, one of those keys to a safer future. May my granddaughter wrap herself in the velvet darkness and lose her gaze in the stars without fearing the shadow at her shoulder.
Thank you very much indeed. Ms Chapman, before calling the next speaker, I'm conscious of how many members want to contribute to the debate. So I'm minded to accept the motion without notice to extend the debate by up to half an hour under Rule 8.14.3. And I would call on Paul McLennan to move such a motion without notice.
Deputy Presiding Officer, formally moved.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. McLennan. The question is now that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? Excellent. That is agreed. And so I call the next speaker, which is Emma Harper, to be followed by Paula Kane for up to 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this 16 Days of Activism Against Gender-Based Violence debate and congratulate my colleague Paul McLennan on securing it. The theme this year is calling for awareness, action and accountability all year round, with a focus on the importance of all men taking action to prevent violence against women and girls. And Jim Fairley has described that really well in his contribution. I add my thanks to the work of organisations tackling gender-based violence, including Zero Tolerance, Scottish Women's Aid, including Wigtonshire and Dumfries Women's Aid, Rape Crisis and White Ribbon Scotland. The recollection of women who have experienced violence and abuse are actually really not easy to hear. And Audrey Nicholl has stated in her comments that the resilience of women who have been survivors should be commended. There is no place for harassment or abuse in any form, whether in the home, in schools, in the workplace or in wider society. And violence against women and girls and indeed LGBT plus and other groups is unacceptable, and international awareness raising activities such as debates like this are crucial to raising the profile of gender-based violence and to tackle its causes. The group UN Women have called violence against women during the COVID-19 pandemic the shadow pandemic, and since the outbreak of COVID-19, emerging data and reports have shown that all types of violence against women and girls, particularly domestic violence, has intensified, and this shadow pandemic needs a global collective effort to stop it. Please check out the Shadow Pandemic campaign on the UN Women website. One of the best ways to tackle gender-based violence is by education. I welcome the Scottish Government's determination to ensure children and young people are receiving high-quality relationship, sexual health and parenthood education in schools. Campaigns such as Police Scotland's Don't Be That Guy are crucial educational resources as they encourage frank conversations with men about gender-based violence and negative stereotypes. The Scottish Government has a number of policies to deal with violence against women and girls and to advance gender equality both here and abroad. Whether here in Scotland or around the world, violence against women is a fundamental violation of human rights, and this is Human Rights Day. The Scottish Government is investing in frontline services and has brought forward new legislation to tackle gender-based violence and discrimination. Scotland rightly aims to set an international example of good practice in gender equality and in the eradication of gender-based violence and create a world where women and girls are safe to achieve their goals. Presiding Officer, in Scotland we are seeing the implementation of the Equally Safe Strategy, which is Scotland's strategy to prevent and eradicate all forms of violence against women and girls. As well as the strategy, it rightly deals with the issues of gender-based violence here in Scotland. It has commitment to preventing international discrimination against women. Members may recall that last January I brought a debate forward on the United Nations Resolution 1325 on women, peace and security. It was unanimously passed by the UN Security Council over 20 years ago, this resolution, number 1325. It was the first of its kind with the aim to specifically address the impact of war on women and the value of women as conflict resolvers. At the heart of the Equally Safe Strategy is the principle that all women and girls, regardless of background, race, religion, sexual orientation or age, should feel safe in their communities and should be without fear of violence or abuse. Internationally, Scotland, working in partnership with the UN, has pledged practical and financial support for women and girls to achieve this goal and to learn peace-building and conflict resolution skills. In the programme supported by the Scottish Government, it consists of talks, seminars and lessons. Women and girls have access to international experts, female role models in positions of power, and the women and girls have the opportunity to learn from each other about the fundamentals of peacekeeping. Actions like this should be commended. Actions like this contribute to strengthen and empower women and girls. The steps that we are taking in Scotland, such as equal safe, equal representation on public boards and gender balanced cabinet, a commitment to a wellbeing economy and to educate women and girls to tackle gender-based violence are also welcome. It is important that the Scottish Government will introduce legislation to protect the anonymity of complainers of sexual crimes under Scots law, and I welcome that serious consideration will be given to introduce special courts and allow victims to pre-record their evidence. In closing, Presiding Officer, I welcome this debate and I join calls for men to call out gender-based violence, and I welcome Scotland's outward-looking approach to tackling gender-based violence. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Paul O'Kane to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick. Around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I begin my contribution today by thanking all the members here for the valuable contributions we have heard so far in this debate, and it is an honour for me to follow my colleagues Paula McNeill and Carol Mockin. And indeed, I think to thank members for their work in raising awareness of gender-based violence, but particularly Paul McLennan for bringing this vitally important debate to Parliament this evening, and for his encouragement of men and male MSPs to participate in this debate and show a willingness to lead by example and take action. What we have heard already is shocking about the murders of women and girls. And I think there are circumstances that have been articulated particularly powerfully by colleagues. That day-to-day experience of violence and the fear of violence is harrowing and should shock all of us. And I want to pay tribute tonight to the work that is done by so many organisations, such as Women's Aid and Rape Crisis Scotland that we've heard already, to take action and to support women and girls year on year. And we know that as we gather tonight to again mark another 16 days of activism, we have seen again instances of domestic violence and abuse go up, and that is a pattern that increases year on year. And it should be abundantly clear to all of us that there is so much more that needs to be done. Because women and girls should not have to go about their day-to-day lives in fear of what may happen to them. They should not have to change their behaviour. Our mothers, our daughters, our sisters, cousins and friends should not have to think about their route home, where they run or where they go for a night out. We can do more and we must do more. Men can do more and must do more. As we know, it is we're marking the 16 days of activism against gender-based violence, and the campaign is so important because it helps to shine a spotlight on what can be done to begin to stop horrific violence that happens in our communities. And I'm reflecting this evening that as we mark 30 years, I was 3 years old when these 16 days and the campaign around those 16 days began. And I was struck by the contribution of Paula McNeill in this regard, that for all of my time growing up and at school, I wasn't aware of these 16 days of activism. I wasn't aware of the need for men and teenage boys at school to take account of their actions, to think about their attitudes. And there was very little, I think, in the way of education, involvement, and helping young men particularly to think about their role in all of this. And I think, you know, Paula McNeill articulated very clearly that we must do more in our schools to have young men particularly think and reflect upon their behaviours. And I think the Police Scotland campaign is a start in that regard to make young men particularly think about not being that guy and what they do and what they say. I want to highlight, if I can, in my time remaining, the work of the White Ribbon campaign in Scotland. I had the great honour of getting to know that campaign well through my work at COSLA, as I'm sure Paul McLennan did also. And that campaign seeks to ask men to make a pledge to call out inappropriate behaviour when they hear it and when they see it, and to be very, very clear that they will never walk on by when they see that behaviour, and they won't condone violence against women or excuse it as you know, just a joke or just par for the course. So the reality is that that pledge is a starting point. It will never be an end in itself, but it's about all men in Scotland being able to take that pledge to make a contribution and to say that in my own sphere of influence, whether that be in my workplace, whether it be in my home, or whether it be in the pub or where I socialise, I have a duty to call out those around me and to ensure that I can take action so that we can begin to make clear that violence against women and girls is never acceptable and that we all have a role in making sure that we put an end to it. So I will close there. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. O'Kain. I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick to be followed by Neil Bibby. Again, around 4 minutes, Mr. Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you also to Paul McLennan for highlighting activism against gender-based violence. To mark the start of the 16 days of activism on the 25th of November, hundreds gathered in Dundee at a march to reclaim the night. And I want to pay tribute to the Women's Rape and Sexual Abuse Centre in particular for leading at this event and to all the other groups involved in making the march and other events a success. I want to thank them not just for their contribution to the march, but also for the work they do every day of the year. So those include Dundee Violence Against Women's Partnership, Dundee International Women's Centre, Women's Aid, Rape Crisis Scotland, the university societies and local secondary schools across Dundee. I'd also like to pay tribute to the V&A at Dundee, Police Scotland, Dundee City Churches, the Hot Chocolate Trust, Dundee City Council, Leisure and Culture Dundee, Dundee Contemporary Arts and the University of Dundee for hosting workshops and lighting the prominent buildings in our city to mark this occasion. And also to all those across Dundee and elsewhere in Scotland and around the world who lit candles, torches and lights to make sure that this day was properly remembered and recognised. Over the 16 days, as well as the march, there's been ongoing arts and craft classes and musical events all over Dundee. And I know that's been replicated across Scotland and indeed around the world. The buzz created by these events has been immense. However, it is crucial to remember why this 16-day event is required. Whilst all this incredible work has been ongoing, I've been contacted by constituents who've reported women being spiked by injection in licensed premises in Dundee. There have been newspaper reports of further cases, and I know that Police Scotland are investigating several complaints. Members across the chamber will no doubt have received similar correspondence. Presiding Officer, we know from work published by the United Nations that one in three women worldwide, an estimated 736 million, have experienced physical or sexual violence. And we know the consequences of such violence often has devastating effects on those women. We know that 15 million adolescent girls worldwide aged 15 to 19 have experienced forced sex. We know that an average of 137 women are killed by a member of their own family every day. We know that fewer than 40% of the women who experience violence seek help of any sort. And we know that violence against women disproportionately impacts on lower income areas. These are just some of the horrifying numbers reported by the United Nations. They make hugely uncomfortable reading, particularly for the men in the chamber and in society. But behind every single one of those statistics is a woman, and we must endeavour to remember that and to make a difference. Whilst it may be the case that not all men commit violence against women, it is incumbent on all of us, as has been said by many members in the chamber, every single one of us to call it out, to help to end it. I'd like to conclude, Presiding Officer, by joining Paul O'Kane and colleagues across the chamber in making the White Ribbon Scotland pledge never to commit, condone or remain silent about men's violence against women in all of its forms. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Fitzpatrick. Can I echo that pledge too and now call the final speaker in the open debate, Neil Bibby. Again, around 4 minutes, Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I applaud all the work that has been done as part of the 16 days of action against gender-based violence from the international level down to local councils and organisations in my West Scotland region who have chosen to establish their own 16-day initiatives. And I applaud Paul McLennan for this important motion and debate. It is a truly shocking state of affairs, however, that this year marks the 30th anniversary of the Global 16 Days campaign, and that the campaign is apparently needed now more than ever. The appalling and sickening murder of Sarah Everard in March this year was a reminder, as if one were needed, that women cannot feel safe on our streets. Like other members, I urge every man listening to think about that, Presiding Officer, really think about that and what it must feel like to feel vulnerable to physical violence and sexual attack from the moment you leave a home or a workplace and enter a street or any public place. For most men, this is not something we have to think about, if ever. But for women, it is automatic, every day, all the time. Just from speaking to women in my own family or in my own office, they have spoken of the daily precautions they take to avoid the threat of male violence. Walking even on a busy street in daylight close to the road edge of a pavement in order to avoid alleyways and doorways, carrying their keys between their fingers in case they need an improvised weapon without notice. And of course, not walking home, just not travelling on public transport, just not going out at all because of all the worries and logistics it entails. If men had to live like this, Presiding Officer, I suspect the problem would have been dealt with a very long time ago. But most of us don't. We really have to think or worry about it. Well, Presiding Officer, we should think about it, and we should talk about it, as Jim Fairley said, and we should have the political will to do something about it, as Polly McNeill and Carol Mockin said. We should try to imagine what it feels like to live like that day in and day out. It's an outrage that anyone should have to, never mind half of the human population. What is more, Presiding Officer, many women are not, of course, safe from violent men, even in their own homes. According to figures referenced by Russell Finlay, a woman is killed by a man in the UK every 3 days. Most such women die at the hands of domestic partners. Many suffer long-term abuse prior to their deaths at the hands of those men. And as Stephen Kerr said, the COVID pandemic has made matters worse for those for whom home is anything but a sanctuary. UN research has found that since the pandemic, women on a global scale feel significantly less safe and less secure. This is because of male violence, Presiding Officer. Of course, as Joe Fitzpatrick said, not all men are violent predators, but we must take collective responsibility for our collective behaviour as a sex. As the motion states, all men must take action to prevent and eliminate violence against women and girls. We must appreciate that women and girls do not know who may be a threat or who may not. We must be sensitive about our own behaviour and speech and how it might be interpreted by others. I agree with Maggie Chapman and many other members who have said that we must call out and challenge unacceptable male behaviour whenever we see it. Clearly, there's a huge role for government, the police and public policy here. I agree with Paul McLennan. We need to see real change urgently and certainly before we debate this next year. And I commit to working with Mr McLennan and all my other members here on this important issue. But I also agree with Mr McLennan and others that the onus is on men, all men, to recognise the reality of life for our daughters, wives, partners, friends and mothers. Men need to face the fact that women live every day with the spectre of male violence, Presiding Officer. That should sicken us and call on us to act. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Bibby. I now call on Ben McPherson to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like colleagues, first of all, I congratulate Paul McLennan on securing this debate and all members who supported his motion. I also want to pay tribute to all members who have contributed to our debate this evening and this important discussion, and also the debates we had on the 25th of November and the 30th of November. Presiding Officer, it was with a profound sadness that I begin by sending my thoughts and condolences to the family of Amber Gibson at this extremely difficult time. I understand that Police Scotland are treating Amber's tragic death as murder, and her name, tragically and shockingly and sickeningly, joins those of Sabina Nessa, Sarah Everard, Nicole Smallman and Beba Henry, and far, far too many other women and girls who have been senselessly and heinously killed in our country and around the world. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government agrees with what all colleagues have said today, and that is that if gender-based violence is a function of gender inequality, is an abuse of male power and privilege, and has others have emphasised, the common denominator is men, as Russell Finlay rightly stated. It takes the form of actions that result in physical and psychological harm or suffering to women and children, and is an affront to their human dignity. That is why the Scottish Government are already taking forward a large amount of actions and work to support victims of gender-based violence and address the misogynistic attitudes that perpetuate such violence. For example, we established an independent working group chaired by Baroness Helena Kennedy QC to specifically look at misogyny in Scotland and explore whether there should be a standalone offence to tackle misogynistic conduct. The working group has concluded its evidence gathering and have confirmed that the report on its findings and recommendations will be published in February next year. The Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland Act 2021, when it comes into effect, will provide new powers for the police and courts to make emergency orders designed to protect people who are at risk of domestic abuse from someone they are living with. And the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018 has also made a meaningful difference as a gold standard piece of legislation in strengthening the law and gives police greater opportunities and powers to tackle this insidious crime. And very early data shows an encouraging 84% conviction rate, although it is very early data. But we do need to consider how we do more in the criminal justice space, as well as elsewhere in government policy. And certainly on behalf of ministers, accept Paul McClellan's request for a meeting. If he follows up in correspondence, we'll decide which ministers should be most engaged in that, and thank him for that constructive proposal. Certainly, yes.
Pauline McNeill.
First, commend the minister a number of excellent speeches he's made on the subject and the work the Scottish Government is doing. But twice in the chamber I've raised this question of what's been happening in some schools in England where girls have been subjected to unsolicited graphic images, and boys too to some extent. I think Paula Kane made his point really well, that there is an issue, we don't really know what's going on in schools, and I wondered if that's something the Scottish Government thought about addressing to try and find out what is actually going on, because perhaps the gender stereotyping of boys and what the expectation of boys is a factor in all of this, and to make that direct connection. In some ways, I actually might think it might be worse for young people now than it was in my day. But it's something I wonder if the Minister would agree that we need to explore in this Parliament.
Minister, and I can give you the time back.
Thank you. And I think Pauline McNeill raises really important points that I was going to come to an extent later on. But I do think, in answer to her question, that as part of Mr. McClellan's work, we need to consider the educational environment as part of that and look purposefully at the analysis that's been done about the attitudes of young men growing up in Scotland at the moment and what we can do to change those attitudes more positively where that's required. I should say that there's been so many good speeches and points made in this debate, I won't manage to address them all, but I will try as much as possible in the time remaining. As I talked about legislation, Presiding Officer, as an important tool in making a positive contribution to tackling gender-based violence. Also important is our support for organisations working to support victims and survivors and discourage gender-based violence. And over the past 18 months, the Scottish Government invested an additional £10 million to allow rapid redesign of services and address backlogs supporting organisations such as Scottish Women's Aid and Rape Crisis Scotland. And also, as part of our £100 million three-year commitment to tackling violence against women and girls, we have also created a new Delivering Equally Safe Fund and have recently confirmed allocations to 121 projects from 112 organisations working to provide key services and prevent gender-based violence. And we also opened a new victim-centred approach fund in October to support victims of crime worth at least £30 million over the next 3 years. And of course, in all policy areas, gender equality is a focus of the government, and I think Audrey Nicol made this point very well, and certainly in my responsibilities for Scotland's new social security system, this is a point of considerable, quite rightly considerable emphasis, and I meet with organisations involved like Engender on a regular basis. But in the time remaining, Presiding Officer, I want to focus on the key points that are in Mr McClellan's motion and that many other speakers touched on, which is about how as a society we need to do more across the board, but also how together and individuals we can do more, particularly as men, to address this issue, to change culture and social attitudes, because some are more to blame, some men are more to blame, the perpetrators, but we have a collective responsibility, as Jim Fairley emphasised, across all ages, to do more. Gender-based violence is a manifestation of toxic masculinity, the commodification of women, porn culture, and an immoral set of attitudes that includes a sense of sexual entitlement in the minds of too many men in our society and around the world. And it is men who have created this imbalance in our society, so men have a duty to lead the change that we need to see. Men need to look in the mirror and do so critically, as Maggie Chapman emphasised, to address these issues. It is vital that we bring forward change that is societal, behavioural, cultural and systematic. We need that change in workplaces, in nightclubs, in bars and in all other settings, including, of course, in the streets. The Police Scotland new campaign, Don't Be That Guy, encapsulates how gender-based violence is not simply made up of the most severe crimes that come to mind, but it can be a process of escalation that Stephen Kerr rightly spoke about. But it is not enough to just say that we are not that guy. We also have to change our collective behaviour and call out men who are around us in their behaviour. Because men, the onus is on us to modify our collective behaviour and to do so in a way that is sensitive to the situation that women around us face. And that is why I support campaigns such as White Ribbon and He for She, which promote the positive and active steps that men and boys can take to challenge violence against women and girls and misogyny when they see it. And I encourage all men to make that commitment to doing more. Presiding Officer, my message is to men and boys that we need to do more. We need to be that guy who does more to tackle and prevent violence against women and girls collectively. We need to be that guy who calls out his mates when he hears or sees sexism, misogyny, abuse or harassment. We need to be that guy who modifies his behaviour to make women feel safer, like crossing the road, for example, as was said by one of our speakers today. And we need to be that guy who plays a part in bringing about the change in culture that we need to see. So from today, there's a collective call to action for government to do more, for society to do more, for individuals to do more, and for us collectively to do more. But I think Paul McClellan rightly asked us as MSPs to do more. And I think, as well as in my ministerial capacity and other ministers, we'll look at that as part of the work that will come out of these 16 days, what more can be done across government. But also as MSPs, when we go and speak to schools, when we go and speak to sports clubs, well, we should be thinking about how we create greater awareness of the fact that men need to take responsibility. So the momentum that we've seen over the course of the 16 days of activism so far has been important, but we must not relent after the 10th of December. We need to move forward and do more and remain united in our condemnation of violence against women and girls in all its forms in Scotland and around the world and recommit to doing all we can to tackling it and in time ending it as soon as possible. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.